Good day, everyone. This is Doc Ina. The topic for this lecture is abnormal uterine bleeding, or AUB. The main reference for this lecture is Comprehensive Gynecology, 7th edition, Chapter 26, Abnormal Uterine Bleeding. To download this lecture deck for free, you can either go to slideshare.net or my WordPress site. The outline for this lecture is the following. We first define what is AUB, then learn about the classification and pathophysiology of AUB, how to diagnose AUB, and finally the treatment of acute and chronic AUB. So what is abnormal uterine bleeding? It's actually one of the most common health concerns of women nowadays. It can present in many ways, from infrequent episodes to excessive flow, which is what we call heavy menstrual bleeding. But on this lecture, we will focus only on heavy menstrual bleeding. Let us review the normal menstrual blood flow. The mean duration of the menstrual cycle is about 28 plus or minus 7 days, while the average menstrual blood loss, or what we call MBL, is around 35 ml, with a normal range of 10 to 80 ml. The average number of days of menses is around 4 days, with a normal range of 2 to 7 days. Now, any deviation from all these normal parameters is what we call AUB. So, if your bleeding occurs at intervals of 21 days or less, or 35 days or more, it's abnormal uterine bleeding. If the bleeding lasts longer than 80 days, or you have an MBL of 80 ml or greater, that is considered AUB, or abnormal uterine bleeding. The term dysfunctional uterine bleeding, or DUB, is no longer favored and should be discarded. This is the palm coin classification of abnormal uterine bleeding, and each of the letters in this acronym represent the structural or anatomic and non-anatomic causes of AUB. So the palm part represents the non-anatomic causes, or the coin part represent the non-anatomic causes. So P stands for polyp, P for adenomyosis, L for leiomyoma, M for malignancy and hyperplasia, C for coagulopathy, O for ovulatory dysfunction, E for endometrial, I for iatrogenic, and N for not yet classified. This is a suggested way of writing down a diagnosis of AUB using the palm coin classification. So the acronym AUB is followed by the letters palm coin, and a subscript of 0 or 1 is associated with each letter to indicate the absence or presence respectively of the abnormality. So for example, in a patient with abnormal uterine bleeding due to a polyp, so first we write AUB followed by the letters palm coin, and you notice here that P has a subscript of 1, and the rest of the letters in the acronym has a subscript of 0. So for AUB palm coin with a subscript of 1 for P means that a patient has AUB due to endometrial polyp. So what if a patient has two or more etiologies for AUB? For example, in a patient with AUB that is both irregular and heavy, and she may have endometrial hyperplasia due to an ovulation. So her etiologies are malignancy and ovulatory dysfunction. So that will be AUB, palm coin, with a subscript of 1 for M, and a subscript of 1 for O, and a subscript of 0 for the rest of the letters in the acronym. Let us now discuss the pathophysiology of AUB based on the palm coin classification. So first, AUBT, or AUB due to endometrial polyps. Endometrial polyps are localized overgrowths of endometrial tissue, and they contain glands and stroma and blood vessels covered with epithelium. These are most commonly found in reproductive age women, and estrogen stimulation is thought to play a key role in their development. These polyps are usually benign, and women with symptomatic polyps can be treated safely and effectively with operative hysteroscopy. Next, next is ABA or AB secondary to adenomyosis. Adenomyosis is defined as the presence of endometrial glands and stroma in the uterine myometrium. And this ectopic endometrial tissue leads to hypertrophy of the surrounding myometrium. Multiparity is the most significant risk factor for the development of adenomyosis, but it is also theorized that any process that allows for penetration of the endometrial glands and stroma past the basalis layer, such as dilatation and curettage, cesarean delivery, and spontaneous abortion, can lead to the development of adenomyosis. The most common presentation of adenomyosis is unenlarged asymmetric uterus on ultrasound and even on internal examination. Abnormal uterine bleeding due to adenomyosis is mostly secondary to altered uterine contractility and is associated with profound dysmenorrhea. Next is AUBL or AUB secondary to leiomyoma or fibroids, which are benign tumors of the uterine myometrium. Its pathogenesis is mainly myometrial injury, leading to cellular proliferation, decreased apoptosis, increased production of extracellular matrix, and overexpression of transforming growth factor beta that leads to fibrosis of these tumors. The mechanisms by which fibroids cause abnormal uterine bleeding are varied, and it mostly depends on the size, location, and number, but mostly the location of the fibroids. There are three types of fibroids or leiomyoma: the intracavitary or submucous type, intramural fibroids, and subserous fibroids. But mostly, it's the intracavitary or the submucous type of fibroids that can cause abnormal uterine bleeding. As for the management of these tumors, we can either offer medical management or surgical management in the form of hysterectomy or myomectomy. Next is AUBM or AUB secondary to malignancy or hyperplasia. The types of gynecologic malignancies that can cause AUB are vulvar, vaginal, cervical, endometrial, uterine, and adnexal cancers such as ovarian or fallopian tube cancers. The bleeding from cervical malignancy classically presents as post-coital bleeding or intermenstrual spotting. Endometrial cancer is mostly secondary to prolonged exposure to hyperestrogenic state, such as chronic anovulation, PCOS, obesity, nuligravidity, and the like. Lynch syndrome or hereditary non-polyposis colorectal cancer is an autosomal dominant disease caused by a disruption in the mismatch repair genes or the MMR genes, and this carries a 40 to 50% lifetime risk of endometrial cancer. Estrogen-producing ovarian tumors can also cause abnormal uterine bleeding, an example of which would be granulosa fecal cell tumors. Next is AUBC or AUB secondary to coagulopathy. These are disorders of blood coagulation, and the most common of which is von Willebrand disease. Other coagulopathies that can cause AUB include prothrombin deficiency, hemophilia, leukemia, severe sepsis, idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura, and hypersplenism. Routine screening may be indicated for the adolescent who has prolonged heavy menses beginning at menarche. In adults, screening for these disorders are indicated by clinical signs such as bleeding gums, epistaxis, or ecchymosis. Other disorders that produce platelet deficiency, such as chronic anticoagulation as a result of heparin, low molecular weight heparin, direct thrombin inhibitors, and direct factor XA inhibitors are also included under this classification. And this is the recommended diagnostic approach to adults with abnormal uterine bleeding due to coagulopathy. Next is AUBO or AUB secondary to ovulatory dysfunction. An ovulation is most common during the extremes of reproductive life, during the first few years after menarche and during perimenopause. In the adolescent, an ovulation is due to an immaturity of the hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis. While in the perimenopausal woman, there is lack of synchronization between the components of the HPO axis. The predominant cause of ovulatory dysfunction among postmenarchial and premenopausal women is mostly alterations in the neuroendocrine function. So in ovulatory dysfunction, there is continuous estradiol production without corpus luteum formation and progesterone production. Therefore, without progesterone, there is continuous proliferation of the endometrium, which may outgrow its blood supply and therefore lead to necrosis of the endometrium. Without progesterone, there is no uniform slough to the basalis layer, which produces excessive uterine bleeding. The patterns of anovulatory bleeding may be oligomenorrhea, intermenstrual bleeding, or heavy menstrual bleeding. So what are the causes of anovulation? As I've said, first foremost of which would be extremes of reproductive life. Another example would be polycystic ovary syndrome. Another is hypothalamic dysfunction that is related to weight loss, severe exercise, stress, or drug use, and abnormalities of other non-reproductive hormones such as thyroid hormones, prolactin, and cortisol. Next is AUTI or AUB secondary to iatrogenic causes. These are mostly due to medications that the patient is taking. Most common of these are the hormonal preparations, including selective estrogen receptor modulators and gonadotropic releasing hormone agonists and antagonists. Hyperprolactinemia can result from central nervous system dopamine antagonism of certain antipsychotic drugs, such as risperidone. The combined and progesterone-only oral contraceptives may result in breakthrough bleeding. Interactions between oral contraceptives and other medications such as antibiotics and anticonvulsants may alter circulating levels of steroids, allowing follicular recruitment and increased endogenous levels of estrogen, and therefore bleeding. Next is AABE or AAB secondary to endometrial causes. Heavy menstrual bleeding in the absence of other abnormalities are thought to have underlying disorders of the endometrium or are otherwise unclassified. So in the past, this category was called ovulatory dysfunctional uterine bleeding or DUB. Okay, the primary line of defense to excessive bleeding during normal menses is the formation of the platelet plug, followed by uterine contractility, largely mediated by prostaglandin F2-alpha. Thus, prolonged and heavy bleeding can occur with abnormalities of the platelet plug and inadequate levels of PGF2-alpha or prostaglandin F2-alpha. In some women with heavy menstrual bleeding, there is excessive uterine production of prostacytin. This is a vasodilatory prostaglandin that opposes platelet adhesion and may also interfere with uterine contractility. Deficiency of uterine PGF2-alpha or excessive production of PGE, which is a vasodilatory prostaglandin, may also explain ovulatory DUB. Low PGF2-alpha to PGE ratio will increase menstrual blood loss. And finally, AUBN or AUB not otherwise specified. This is abnormal uterine bleeding not classified in the previous categories. Examples of such conditions may include foreign bodies or trauma. The treatment is tailored to the specific cause. Let us now discuss the diagnostic approach for AUB. First is doing a thorough medical history. So we ask the patient about the frequency, duration, and amount of bleeding, and we inquire whether and when the menstrual pattern changed. So from these details, we describe the menstrual abnormality, whether it is oligomenorrhea, is it polymenorrhea, or heavy menstrual bleeding or intermenstrual bleeding. Encourage the patient to record her bleeding episodes in a menstrual calendar because this will be helpful to characterize definitively the bleeding episodes. And if abnormal uterine bleeding has been present for the majority of the preceding 6 months, then this patient has chronic AUB. For all patients, you determine the age at menarche, the cycle length, the duration of bleeding, the perception of flow, is it heavy, medium, or just light? What are the menstrual products that she is using? For example, is she using diapers or tampons? What is the first day of her last menstrual period? Does the patient have dysmenorrhea? This is an example of a menstrual calendar. Here are some tips or pointers to help us determine if the patient has heavy menstrual bleeding. Are her menses lasting more than 7 days? Is the patient soaking through pads or tampons in an hour for 2 to 3 hours in a row? Does the patient require frequent pad or tampon changes? Is she passing blood clots more than an inch in diameter? Is the patient using double protection? Is the patient reporting flooding or gushing sensation? Does the patient have frequent accidents or leaking through protection? Does she have hemorrhage from a corpus luteum? Is she diagnosed with anemia? Or does she have history of excessive bruising or bleeding or a family history of a bleeding disorder? Ask whether your patient has a personal history of any of the following symptoms: epistaxis, spontaneous bruising, minor wound bleeding, bleeding from an oral cavity or GI tract without an obvious anatomic lesion, prolonged or excessive bleeding after dental extraction or surgery, and hemorrhage that required transfusion. Inquire about her social history. Are there social stressors, substance abuse, and exercise patterns and athletic competition? Ask about her family history of bleeding disorders, menstrual disorders, diabetes, and thyroid. Ask about her past medical history. Does she have any systemic illnesses, including hematologic or renal disease, and current or recent medications? Inquire about her sexual history, especially contraception and condom use, the number of sexual partners, history of STDs, a history of a previous pregnancy or abortion, and history of sexual abuse or assault. Next is doing a thorough physical examination of the patient. Of course, you have to determine vital signs. Does the patient have tachycardia or hypotension, which may signal acute hemodynamic instability and the need for rapid intervention? Does the patient have tachycardia or pallor or a heart murmur that can suggest anemia? Note for any petechiae or excessive bruising, which may suggest a platelet defect or another bleeding disorder. Note for obesity, acne, hirsutism, and acanthosis nigricans, which may be present in a patient with PCOS. Palpate the thyroid gland for any enlargement or other abnormalities. Examine the optic fundi and do visual field testing. Determine sexual maturity rating of the breast and assess for galactorrhea. Palpate the abdomen for any enlargement or any mass in the uterus or ovary. For most patients, external inspection of the genitalia may be sufficient. However, for a sexually active patient, a complete pelvic examination may be warranted. For laboratory evaluation, the most important first step is to do a pregnancy test to rule out pregnancy, especially among patients of reproductive age. Next, of course, is to do a complete blood count, including differential and platelet count and blood typing. Measure also the iron stores and determine prothrombin time and activated partial thromboplastin time. We can also request for von Willebrand studies, especially if our patient is an adolescent. We can also ask or request for TSH or thyroid stimulating hormone, test for chlamydia trachomatis and Neisseria gonorrhea, and request for a pelvic ultrasound. For patients with a history of amenorrhea or irregular bleeding prior to the onset of heavy bleeding, then we can request for FSH and LH, total and free testosterone levels, dehydroepiandrosterone, and prolactin levels. For the last part, we discuss the treatment of both acute and chronic AUB. The management of AUB depends on the assessment of whether or not the patient is hemodynamically stable, determination of the underlying cause, medical management based on etiology, and the severity of anemia. The goals of treatment are to establish and or maintain hemodynamic stability, to correct acute or chronic anemia, to return to a pattern of normal menstrual cycles, to prevent recurrence, and to prevent long-term consequences of anovulation, example, anemia, infertility, and endometrial cancer. For the medical treatment, the goal of medical therapy is to stabilize the endometrium with estrogen that will provide initial hemostasis followed by progestins for endometrial stability. Typically, this is achieved with combined oral contraceptive pills taken continuously for several months until hemodynamically stable, as withdrawal of either hormone will cause recurrent bleeding. Episodes of moderate to severe bleeding can typically be treated effectively with frequent dosing of combined oral contraceptive pills. In the absence of an organic cause for excessive uterine bleeding, it is preferable to use medical instead of surgical treatment, especially if the woman desires to retain her uterus for future childbearing or will be undergoing natural menopause within a short time. The type of treatment depends on whether it is used to stop an acute heavy bleeding episode or is given to reduce the amount of menstrual blood loss or MBL in subsequent menstrual cycles. Remember, a definitive diagnosis is required before instituting long-term treatment and should be made on the basis of hysteroscopy, sonohysterography, or directed endometrial biopsies. For abnormal uterine bleeding due to ovulatory dysfunction, for adolescents, after ruling out coagulation disorders, the main direction of therapy is to temporize because once the HPO axis matures, then the problem will be corrected. Here are some of the available medications for adolescents. Cyclic progestogen in the form of medroxyprogesterone acetate 10 mg for 10 days each month for a few months to produce reliable and controlled menstrual cycles. We can also give oral contraceptive pills if the problem persists beyond 6 months. For the perimenopausal woman and the reproductive age woman, we can give low-dose combined oral contraceptives and cyclic progestogens. For women with heavy menstrual bleeding for whom there is no known cause and anatomic lesions have been ruled out, that is AUBE or AUB endometrial, the aim of therapy is to reduce the amount of excessive bleeding. Now, some women with AUBE have abnormal prostaglandin production, and some have alterations of endometrial blood flow. The options for treatment for these women include the following: prolonged regimen of progestogens, like 3 weeks each month, oral contraceptive pills, and levonorgestrel intrauterine system, or LNG-IUS. We can also offer NSAIDs or non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs for abnormal uterine bleeding. Prostaglandin synthetase inhibitors inhibit the biosynthesis of the cyclic endoperoxides, which convert arachidonic acid to prostaglandins. NSAIDs block the action of prostaglandins by interfering directly at the receptor sites. All NSAIDs are cyclooxygenase inhibitors and thus block the formation of both thromboxane and the prostacycline pathway. Nevertheless, NSAIDs have been shown to reduce NBF primarily in women who ovulate. Examples of NSAIDs include mefenamic acid, 500 mg 3 times daily, ibuprofen, 400 mg 3 times daily, naproxen sodium, 275 mg every 6 hours, after a loading dose of 550 mg. And all of this can be given in the first 3 days of menses or the whole duration of the bleeding. We can also offer anti-fibrinolytic agents in the form of EACA, tranexamic acid, para-aminomethylbenzoic acid. Their use is somewhat limited by their side effects, and these are mainly GI side effects which can be minimized by reducing the dose and limiting the therapy to the first 3 to 5 days of bleeding. Due to the increased risk of thrombosis and myocardial infarction, antifibrinolytic agents should not be combined with oral contraceptives. Another option is to offer the patient gonadotropin-releasing hormone agonist. GnRH agonists may be used to inhibit ovarian steroid production as estrogen production is necessary for endometrial proliferation. Because of the expense and menopausal side effects of these agents, their use is limited only for women with severe NBL who fail to respond to other methods of medical management and wish to retain their childbearing capacity. More commonly, GnRH agonists are an effective means of bridging patients to surgical treatment, allowing for correction of anemia. Use of an estrogen or progestogen, that's the ADVAP therapy, together with the agonist will help prevent bone loss. Let's discuss the management of acute bleeding. In women who are bleeding heavily and are hemodynamically unstable, the quickest way of stopping acute bleeding is through curettage. Curettage should also be the preferred approach for older women and those patients with medical risk factors for whom high-dose hormonal therapy may pose a great risk. Acute AAB may also be managed medically or pharmacologically. To stop acute bleeding that does not require curettage, the most effective regimen involves giving high-dose estrogen, whether orally or through IV. High-dose estrogen is aimed at stopping acute bleeding and is merely a temporary measure. Estrogen in pharmacologic doses causes rapid growth of the endometrium. A rapid growth of endometrial tissue occurs over the denuded and raw epithelial surfaces. Large doses of estrogen may alter platelet activity, thus promoting platelet adhesiveness. And here are some of the options. Oral conjugated equine estrogen or CEE 10 mg per day in 4 divided doses. IV conjugated estrogen, 25 mg every 4 to 6 hours until the bleeding stops. Combination oral contraceptives that contains both estrogen and progestin. 4 tablets of an oral contraceptive containing 30 to 35 micrograms of estrogen taken every 24 hours in divided doses. For patients with contraindication to estrogen, then we can offer progestogens or progestins. Progestogens not only stop endometrial growth, but also support and organize the endometrium so that an organized slough occurs after the withdrawal. With progestogen treatment, an organized slough to the basalis layer allows a rapid cessation of bleeding. Progestogens stimulate arachidonic acid formation in the endometrium, increasing the PGF2-alpha to PGE ratio. Here are some of the options. Medroxyprogesterone acetate or MPA, 60 mg daily for 7 days, followed by 20 mg per day for 3 weeks. Depo MPA, 150 mg intramuscular, followed by oral MPA, 60 mg for 3 days, or norethindrone acetate, 30 mg per day. We can also offer androgens in the form of danazol. Danazol is a synthetic androgen used in doses of 200 mg daily for the treatment of heavy menstrual bleeding. However, danazol is only of limited use because of its side effects of weight gain and skin problems. Some patients need hospitalization, and these are the indications for confinement. Patients with hemodynamic instability, patients with hemoglobin concentration of less than 7 or less than 10 if with active heavy breathing, patients with symptomatic anemia, patients who need intravenous conjugated estrogen, and finally patients who need surgical intervention. Let us now discuss surgical management for acute AUB. First is dilatation and curettage, or DNC. DNC is both diagnostic and therapeutic for the immediate management of severe bleeding. For women with markedly excessive uterine bleeding who may be hypovolemic, DNC is the quickest way to stop acute bleeding. And this is the treatment of choice in hypovolemic women. DNC may be preferred as an approach to stop an acute bleeding episode in women older than 35 with the incidence of pathologic findings increase. DNC is only indicated for women with acute bleeding resulting in hypovolemia or for older women who are at higher risk of having endometrial neoplasia. All other women, after having an endometrial biopsy, sonohysterography, or diagnostic hysteroscopy to rule out organic disease, are best treated with medical therapy without DNC. Another surgical option is doing endometrial ablation. But we only offer this for patients if medical therapy was not effective or is contraindicated, or in patients who are not any more desirous of pregnancy. Exemptions are women who have very large uteri caused by fibroids or abnormal pathology such as endometrial hyperplasia or cancer. Endometrial ablation is also a good alternative to hysterectomy. The last surgical option is hysterectomy, or the surgical removal of the uterus. This option is reserved for the woman with other indications for hysterectomy, such as leiomyoma or uterine prolapse. This is only offered to women with completed family size, hence, no longer desirous of pregnancy. This is ideal for women with persistent abnormal uterine bleeding after all medical therapy has failed or medical therapy is contraindicated. And lastly, for the treatment options for chronic abnormal uterine bleeding, we can offer levonorgestrel intrauterine system, oral contraceptives in multi or extended cycles, progestogen or progestin therapy, either oral or intramuscular, tranexamic acid, and NSAIDs. Thank you for listening to my lecture, and please don't forget to subscribe.